Oh yes. Yes. Oh yes. So the patient in the balloon. And my Radiosonde. Okay. Okay, Miss Holocaust. Yes.
A weather balloon is a high-altitude balloon which are used to send pressure, temperature, humidity and wind speed data with a device called a Radiosonde. They are equipped with a GPS module and it sends its location to radio receivers. Weather balloons may reach altitudes of 40 km, 25 miles for US or more. Pressure difference inside the balloon increases to such a degree that it disintegrates. The balloon is usually filled with hydrogen or helium. In this instance, the instrument package is usually lost. However, there are many ways to find them yourself. By the way, you have watched an actual weather balloon route. As you saw, it has fallen an open field, and you can go there and pick that up for yourself. There are two websites that are popular for hunting down the weather balloons. First one is the radiosonde.info. Second one is the sondehub.org. I use them with the combination. You can use either one of them. Personally, I like the interface on the sondehub.org, but it's of course just a preference. Weather balloons are launched around the world for observations used to diagnose current conditions, as well as by human forecasters and computer models for weather forecasting. 900 to 1300 locations around the globe do routine releases. That means 2 or 4 times daily. Look how many balloons are on the air just for now and waiting for you to pick it up. As I mentioned, there are many ways to track them. But I will only focus on the two methods that I think they are more convenient than other methods. First method is using a small single board computer like Raspberry Pi or Tinkerboard. If you choose this method, you also need an SDR receiver, that means a software-defined radio receiver. Then you can install Radiosonde Auto RX from GitHub. You can also install this to your Linux laptop if you want, but carrying a Raspberry Pi is more convenient, I think. Before starting hunting, it is important to check Radiosonde support metrics. RS-41 from Vaisala is the most popular one in the Europe, but there are also some countries who uses IMET-4 from the Intermet systems. Installation steps are very well documented, therefore I will not be covering it in this video. Second method that I will mention is installing Radiosonde tracking firmware on a TTGO ESP32 LoRa board. There is an interesting project called MySonde, which is created by Mirko Dalmonte. Again, it is really important to check Radiosonde support metrics in the website. For example, IMET4 Radiosondes are currently not supported. There is also a company in Android app called MySondigo, which connects to the TTGO via Bluetooth. This app plots the location of the Radiosonde on a map, allowing you to easily follow and track down the balloon. This is how my setup looks like. After installing the firmware to the TTGO board and the Android app to my phone, I connected the TTGO board to a power bank. White circles in the sondehub.org are representing the launch sites. If you click on them, you can find their launch schedule. If you zoom in to a balloon, you can see their current location, as well as the predicted falling point. What I see is, predictions are pretty good during normal weathers. But if there is a storm happening somewhere, predictions might fail. If you are wondering, green circles are representing the receivers. From the sondehub.org, I checked the predicted falling location. It was a little far away from my house, so I drove my car to that location. Also, weather was very nice for a car trip too. Unfortunately, it has fallen into a river. I was mostly interested in picking up the Radiosonde from the weather balloon. And case of the Radiosonde is made from the styrofoam mold, and I was hoping to see it on the water surface. However, I couldn't see it anywhere with my naked eyes. I also walked around the beach and searched along the shore. But there was no luck. When I was in the field, Radiosonde.info gave a lost signal status. However, when I went home, I saw that another fellow hunter found it. Good job, FK1967. But I don't give up easily. There was another one predicted to fall just under an hour. So, without losing any more time, I drove to the other predicted location with my car. This time, it was predicted to fall on a village. Sure enough, predictions were right. However, it has fallen into someone else's garden. They picked and even put it on a laundry hanger like a trophy. Third time, it was predicted to fall on a forest. The forest was truly a beautiful place for hiking. People were even horse riding in the forest. However, I'm not here for hiking or horse riding. I am on a mission. When I was in the forest, I found what I was already expecting after seeing how tense the forest was. It fell on a tree and it was pretty high up, so I give up. After having many failed attempts, it was time to set up some strategies for the next try. I decided to not to go more than 30 km during weekdays, and for the weekends, the radius is 60 km. Since it is the springtime, I will only use my bicycle and not my car. I can't think of any better excuse than this for exercising. Also, if it is predicted to fall near a restricted zone, there is no point for going there. Forests are very tricky, because Radiosondes have around 30 meters rope attached to them, and it is almost guaranteed to fall on a tree, and recovery is very hard. So obviously, if it falls on a sea or a large lake, better bring your own boat. Industrial areas seem like they have very open areas, which is true. However, unless you are working there, getting inside is pretty hard. Also, there is no point to go in a city center for recovery, unless you are living only a few blocks from the drop zone. Because if you check the map, almost all of the land is private. It will most probably fall on a home or someone else's garden. Even if it falls on a road, it will be destroyed by cars. While I was looking for a possible recovery mission, I have witnessed a strange phenomenon. It doesn't happen always. However, frequency of the transmitters sometimes change during the flight. But if you would like to go for a hunting, check the frequency during the launch, because it will be the same when it falls on the ground. I don't know why this is happening, and also I am very curious. Please let me know if you know the reason down in the comments. After setting up all the strategies, finally, there was another balloon which was predicted to fall around 25 km from my home. I get on my bike and started pedaling. Weather balloon hunting is not only good for your nerdiness, but also for your health. And because of the excitement and a real purpose, your performance will be a lot better than regular exercise. I promise. This time, it was predicted to fall near to a small lake. The area was open, but I didn't have much expectations because of my previous river experience. Also, there was no sight of any balloon or any threats. Only there were some singing birds and some angry gooses. I went to the other side of the lake and started getting the signal from my Titigo board.
It should be here, but I'm not seeing it. I think I found it. There it is. Finally found it. There is no balloon or anything, but it's here. The first idea is just closing it. I hope it doesn't get broken.
Next time it was predicted to fall on an open field. Finally an easy mission. If you set up your strategies right, you don't lose a lot of time. And also, if you plan to use your own car, you can save a lot of fuel if you follow these strategies. You see, even if you have a very good estimate and you go there, most of the time you cannot see the balloon. A TIGO board or a Raspberry Pi board with an SDR is very essential for this. Even with those, there is almost 10 meters error margin.
It should be here, but I'm not seeing it. Oh yes! Yes! Oh yes! So the pressure in the balloon. And my Radiosonde. Okay. There is all of it. Yes! Whew.
This is how I got two of them on my table. Let's check what do we got inside one of these. You need a screwdriver to open styrofoam casing. First plastic clip is near to the bottom. And the second one is under the label. After removing the plastic clips, you can open the casing easily. There are two AA batteries on the device. The used lithium
maybe
batteries
the reason
on the
is instead the of operating temperature is lower than regular alkaline batteries because it needs to withstand lower temperatures, and also typical weight is a little bit lower than regular battery.
Technical data on the Radiosonde is quite impressive. It is not like your regular Arduino port or any other development port. The main CPU is an STM32 microcontroller. There is an RFID antenna, probably used for setting up the device. And this is also the main temperature and humidity sensor, which stays outside of the casing. Here is a closer picture. You can see the wire antenna, and there is a button and two LEDs. If you turn back the PCB, you will see the GPS chip, and also GPS antenna, and the pressure sensor, and also here you will see the radio interface chip. It is connected to the wire antenna through a matching circuit. The PCB is very well grounded and also has gold plating. Probably they were having signaling issues before. If you want, you can install back the battery holder easily or remove it if you need it. You might ask, what the hell are you going to do with this Radiosonde? You see, they left this open port on it. I believe it is used for programming or setting up the device. You can use a cheap FTDI module to connect it to your computer. I will leave some interesting projects using this Radiosonde down in the description. There are already people who reverse engineered the Radiosonde. If you would like to make your own projects, this GitHub page is a great starting point. Again, I will leave the link down in the description. If you would like to use the existing firmware, you can also do that. To access the existing firmware, often connected to your PC, download the serial console software like PuTTY. All you have to do is to enter the correct port name and click a few checkboxes to enter the system. You can check the correct port name from the device manager. When you power up the Radiosonde and press down the power button, you will see this welcome text on the terminal. Then you should press enter key, type STWSV and press enter again. It's good to mention that you should type it very slowly, otherwise Radiosonde doesn't recognize it. Then you will be welcomed with the hidden service menu. Typing the TX key to select TX state is, I think, very important, because from there you can enable or disable the radio transmission. And if you don't do that, this Radiosonde might be picked up by the other receivers around the world. By typing this, you can read the sensor data. Also keep in mind, all commands are case sensitive. You can also adjust the radio transmission power by typing O. Then type the desired level. 0 is the lowest and 7 is the highest transmission power scale on the firmware. This is important if you would like to use your Radiosonde in your home for other projects, since it will transmit a weaker signal and also battery life will increase. If you would like to launch your own space balloon, for example, setting up a higher transmission power would be logical. You can capture very nice space footage with your own camera and pick it up from where it landed. Also, by typing I, you can change the serial number. Possibilities does not end here. You can also turn it to a high-end Arduino board if you want. For example, I checked where LEDs are connected on the Radiosonde, and I have seen that they are connected to PB7 and PB8. And I am just writing the famous Blink code for two LEDs. As you already guessed, here's your Radiosonde Blinky. Isn't that cute?
There are a few steps to do in order to use your Radiosonde as an Arduino board, and I guess the next video will be about that.
See you next time.